She dreamt she could see this bridge rocking, and this finger pointed at her and said, "You are not to let him go into the mine because you know he hates it." That was the dream. And she, to her, it was a warning.
All human catastrophes may be studied in different phases. No matter what the disaster, human behaviour is similar in each phase.
Don't go down in the mine, Dad. Dreams very often come true. And Daddy, you know, it would break my heart if anything happened to you. So go and tell my dream to your mates, that as sure as the stars do shine, something is going to happen today. Dear Daddy, don't go down the mine.
One of the strangest things about disasters is that afterwards there are always those who claim to have had a presentiment, a dream, a vision, a premonition that something awful was about to happen. For example, a girl told her mother that she did not want to go to school because she had dreamed of something black and terrifying. Her mother sent her off anyway, and she died in the Aberfan disaster. A man driving home from work had a ghastly feeling that something dreadful was to befall his son, and he soon learned that he had died in the Luna Park fire disaster. Coal mining is a dangerous occupation. It creates anxiety in miners and in members of their families. One of the victims of the Appin disaster was forever having nightmares, according to his wife. He would always dream that he was out of his body, struggling vainly to get back into it, and he would wake up shouting. There are many stories of dreams and presentiments of the Mount Kembla mine disaster. Mrs. Hunt, who lost her husband and a son in the disaster, was warned in a dream not to let her son to go into the mine, as is explained by her daughter, Mrs. May Eckford.
She told me different things. She told me of a dream she had. This person warned her not to let him go into the mine.
When did she have that dream?
Before he was killed. And she said she wanted so much to tell him to stay at home, but she couldn't do that because you couldn't let my father go and keep him home, keep my brother at home.
That was Percy, was it? She had a dream about Percy.
Mm-hmm. Yes. She dreamt she could see this bridge rocking, and this finger pointed at her and said, "You are not to let him go into the mine because you know he hates it." That was the dream. And to her, it was a warning.
Turning to the impact phase of the disaster, the Appin explosion exhausted itself underground and was not observable on the surface. Frequently, however, mine explosions are horrendous. The Mount Kembla explosion made the ground on which Mount Kembla village stands lurch and tremble as if hit by an earthquake. The school children, who were in school doing religious instruction, found that their classroom was cracked by the blast. A loud rumble came from the heart of the mountain, and a red tongue of flame writhed from the mine mouth. The explosion was heard at Bulleye in the north and Kaima in the south. A cloud of smoke over Mount Kembla cut out the sun, and fowls, thinking it was nightfall, went to roost.
Thank you.
During the emergency phase, miners initiate their own escapes, the rescue operation is mounted, and the concerned and the curious converge from everywhere on the disaster site. Disaster research has shown that after a disaster, the first spontaneous rescue operations are mounted by those involved in the disaster, and that rescuers attempt first to secure the safety of their own relatives, and when this anxiety is removed, they turn to help others. Hence, a number of fathers and sons perished at Mount Kembla attempting to rescue each other. Eric Hunt, the last survivor of the Mount Kembla disaster, who died in 1980 at the age of 95, led some of his mates to safety and then re-entered the mine to search for his brother. He was motivated by a desire to help first his brother and then, as he said, his poor unfortunate mates.
We hadn't walked 100 yards when up it came. It blew us, it blew me off my feet and it blew me... It blew me off my feet and blew all our lights out. Anyhow, we got into a manhole and we lit our lights and we started to go walk down to the flat again, and we hadn't got far when Adam Frost, the boss, said, "Smell." He said, "Smell." And he took off his lamp and he held it in the gulf. And you could see the flame leave the lamp and go right out. Oh, he says, "Come on." He says, "We've got to go back. We can't go down there." It was the after damp. Well, when we got back to what they call the Tommy Dodds, they're like a cotton reel where the rope goes round a bend. You know those dish cotton wheels?
Yes.
Well, the rope used to rest in them to go round a bend. When we got back up there again, there were 9 or 10 men, and half of them were crying. I didn't know what they were doing. Ah, dear. Anyhow, he said to me, "You go in there and tell those men to come out, there's something wrong." So I went in and told the men to come out. When I got back out to the Tommy Dodds again, Adam Frost had gone out the daylight heading, and there was another dozen men there, and they were calf crying and said that the travelling roads were blocked. They couldn't get out the main road, they couldn't get out the travelling road. Well, I said, "Come on," I said, "I'll take you out." And I took those men out, and we walked a mile or more through the bush and over the gullies before we got to the pit top. We got back to the pit top. They were calling for volunteers to go in for the rescue party. I picked up a lamp and I went back. I went back down the sharp section because I thought I might see my younger brother.
Students of disasters tell us that during the emergency, while the rescue attempts continue, that little grief is expressed because there's just too much to occupy the mind. And we are told of the women at Mount Kembla in a contemporary newspaper report that not many wept. But certainly the saddest recollections of the Mount Kembla disaster are of the grief of the women as they waited, some for up to 60 hours, for news of their loved ones. It's attested of Mary Ryan, for example, she was mother of 2 children under 5, that while she waited in vain for the deliverance of her young husband, that her hair turned white. Some people never forget disasters. The memories and images are known as the death imprint. We see this in the emotional recollection of Eric Hunt.
When we got there, I never saw such a sight in all my life. There were sheets of iron up in the trees, blown off the roof, everything was smashed, the whole front of the rope road, that's where the coal used to come out, the hole that had collapsed. All the travelling roads were blocked, there was no way of getting in and out. Anyhow, when they'd bring a body out and you'd see the women, would... The women would rush to it and let out a scream if it was one of theirs. They'd rush to the stretcher and they'd lift the cover over the body. If it was a relative, they'd let out a scream.
A marked feature of most disasters in the emergency phase is convergence. People from all over the place converge on the disaster site. These people have a variety of motives. Some are anxious relatives. Some, the majority, want to help. A minority are ghouls. and a few even want to exploit the situation for their own advantage. It was reported, for example, that every house in Mount Kembla was robbed, as their occupants were all at the disaster site. The photographs of the convergence scenes at Mount Kembla are very dramatic.
In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones. I keep straining my ears to hear a sound. Maybe someone is digging underground. Or have they given up and all gone home to bed, thinking those who once existed must be dead? Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Don't go talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones. In the event of something happening to me, there is something I would like you all to see. It's just a photograph of someone that I knew. Have you seen my wife, Mr. Jones? Do you know what it's like on the outside? Talking too loud, you'll cause a landslide, Mr. Jones.
At Appin, the scene was different. The disaster occurred in the early hours of the morning. Relatives were contacted by telephone and told not to come, as there was nothing that they could do. The rescue operation was mounted by skilled teams trained by experts in the mine's rescue station, established at Balambi after the Bellbird disaster in 1923. This was a far cry from the crowds of virtually uncontrolled miners who rushed desperately into the pit following the Mount Kembla explosion. At Appin, no risks were taken to recover the bodies of those already known to be dead. And when those bodies were eventually recovered, they were shielded from the media, unlike at Mount Kembla, where the children recollected this day being allowed just to walk among the bodies. Also at Appin, it was very evident that management and unionists, traditional enemies in the war of industry, sunk their differences and cooperated to the full.
Teams of highly trained men from all the other mines in the area was ferried down the 3 kilometre shaft to get to the mine floor, probably the longest 15-minute ride of their lives. With sections of the roof still falling down around them, the ventilation system damaged, and the volatile gases which probably caused the explosion still present, their task was often overwhelming. At this stage, they'd found 13 of their workmates' bodies and were crawling through the blackened pit, aided by only their miner's light, searching for the 14th victim.
If we are of the opinion that the rescue operation itself is in jeopardy, the rescue teams would be brought from the mine, because one life is worth much more than mine.
The first 10 bodies recovered were found in the crib room. The men had been taking their meal break. We were unable to ascertain how they died, but it's understood none was hit or crushed by falling rock. Until about midday, 4 men were still missing. They'd been working in the immediate area of the explosion, and poor ventilation as well as excessive heat from the blast prevented rescue teams entering the area. Then word came that 3 of the missing bodies had been found. Miners' Federation Southern District President Les Olson.
Well, I congratulate every person that's gone underground here today. We've got some terrific people down there, real experts in their job, and we're getting the utmost cooperation from those people, from Mr. Mulock's department, from the management. Everyone is cooperating in a tremendous way.
The phase following the emergency phase is known as the reconstruction phase. This covers the funerals and the memorial services, getting the mine back to work again, relief operations, the awarding of medals and other awards for heroism, and the inquiries, the inquests and the royal commissions, which attempt to ascertain the cause of the disaster and improve the safety of the industry involved. Funerals play an important part in allowing the whole community to express sympathy and release tension. Mining disasters are more than personal tragedies. They are of community-wide concern. Funerals of Kembla victims were so numerous in Wollongong that they created traffic jams. The Appin disaster was also felt by the whole Illawarra community. The funerals of Appin victims were much larger than most funerals, and about 5,000 mourners attended the memorial service at Appin 2 days after the disaster.
The Anglican bishop in Wollongong, Ken Short, opened the service with an announcement that the Archbishop of Sydney, Sir Marcus Lone, had donated $5,000 towards a relief fund for the families of the dead. President of Appin Colliery's Miners' Lodge, David Kemp, spoke to the mourners, with Les Olson, Southern District Miners' Federation President, by his side. He said, "You know, we miners are a funny lot. We argued about all codes of football, particularly between the Aussies and the Poms, about politics, everything from Nifty Nev to Cocky Fraser. But the comradeship and respect we had for each other will never be forgotten." He ended by saying, "Faith is to believe that God brings harmony to your life with neighbours and friends and with the world." Among those at the service were miners who'd stopped work for 24 hours, members of parliament and local government, and the wives and families of those who died. Following disasters, those most involved, such as the relatives of victims, frequently experience a heightened religious awareness. The son of an Appin victim took himself to a church social the Friday after the disaster. He did not join in any of the games. He just sat next to the minister and wouldn't move. Perhaps he felt himself closer to God when he was near a minister. One of the Appin widows, interviewed 18 months after the disaster, said that there really was a guardian angel up there, looking after her family. She said, "So many things have gone right for my daughter since he died. I often think he is up there guiding things for her." It's an interesting idea, the idea that the deceased spouse is still alive and he wants to help in this world, even though he is living in another world. Seems to be a relatively common view following disasters. After the Kembla disaster, Mrs. Hunt had yet another vision, as Mrs. Eckford reports.
"You know, she told me she had the strangest dream again. And she dreamt she was cleaning out this box and she said she heard a voice say, 'Don't cry.' And they used to call her Dickie. 'Don't cry, Dickie. You mustn't cry. We thought you were getting over it.' She said he seemed to be standing in the doorway. She could see him."
"See who?"
"My father."
"Yes."
"It's the same as he was when he was alive. And he said, 'You mustn't cry.' He said, 'We're all here together and we're quite all right.' And she said, I looked up to say something to him and the vision had gone."
A remarkable thing about the Kembla disaster is that it is still commemorated at a memorial service each year on the 31st of July, over 80 years after the disaster.
The small Mount Kembla Church of England, the very church at which funerals were held for the mine victims, became for 2 hours today the site for hundreds of people mourning the nation's largest peacetime disaster. The memorial service was given by Parish Minister, the Reverend James Hall, with an address from Anglican Archbishop of Sydney, the Most Reverend Sir Marcus Lone. Among the mourners, 92-year-old Eric Hunt, the last living survivor of that fateful explosion in 1902. Eric, who is now living in Newcastle, was deemed a hero for his part in rescue operations. During the service, Reverend Hall told of the disaster and how a nation shocked had conducted special services to the dead and offered assistance to grief-stricken families whose husbands, fathers and sons had perished. The tragedy at Mount Kembla lives on as an integral part of Australia's history. What took place here under the shadow of Mount Kembla 75 years ago will never be forgotten.